How everybody doing?
Fuck 12. Drink. I know. What you tell us, man? Geist? Yeah. Blood? Yeah. Sugar? Yeah. Robber? Yeah. Yeah. Finesse? Yeah. Dribble? Yeah. I do it. Yeah. Sticks? Yeah. You do it. Your bitch? Yeah. Wanna fuck? Yeah. Huh? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, oh yeah, 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 oh yeah, 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 bitches, yeah, drink, mollies, yeah, perks, yeah, lean, yeah, homie, yeah, ooh, look with the molly, make your bitch do, look with the molly, look with the drink, make your bitch do, yeah, I'm fucking what, look with the weed, make your bitch do, yeah, fuck it. Look at it perk, make y'all know they do. Yeah, yeah, yo, bitch, back down. I'ma get a hold of Mac down. WWE Smackdown. Yeah, I'm talking raw, nigga. Beat your bitch raw, nigga. Yeah, all in her jaws, nigga. All in her jaws, nigga. Knocking down walls, nigga. Beat your big face up. Yeah, I run around a cake up. Ride around with the cake ups. Yeah, we have it bake up. Bake me a pussy, nigga. Try to play, nigga. I'ma gonna roll you up like a swish and I'ma smoke you, nigga. Yeah, you over with. Yeah, gangster, yeah, blood, yeah, sugar, yeah, killer, yeah, robber, yeah, yeah, finesse, yeah, dribble, yeah, I do it, yeah, sticks, yeah, get to it, yeah, your bitch, yeah, wanna fuck, yeah, 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 oh yeah, 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 oh yeah, 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 money, yeah, 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 bitches, yeah, drink, yeah, mollies, yeah, perks, yeah, weed, yeah, pull me up, down, you try that bitch. Down, you try that hoe.
Today.
Yeah, I don't really give a fuck about that hoe. Give a nine but the slow strokes. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Got your bitch in a room screaming. Yeah.
That's my brother. This is what we doing it for. Say key 419. That's my brother. So we go get into some questions today. But before we get started, like we always do.
Yeah.
Start this off without acknowledging the man, the myth, Pastor Patron. Salute. So a lot of people said that they didn't get a chance to speak with me, and so I decided tonight to come out and give everybody an opportunity, friend or foe, kin or no, put yourself in the box and let me hear what you got to say, right? I want to hear what you got to say. Don't forget to support the Keep Movement, the real Keep Movement, not the fake one. We're going to get it on. Let Visa know. Visa, I need my debate, bro. I need my debate, a healthy debate, and the topic is Jesus God? Since you said that he wasn't, I say that he is. The Bible says prove all things, and so I'm going to prove, and this probably might be the deepest thing that you ever heard. We go into my mind, and you can check my work because I always bring receipts. So I'm going to put it on. Put my knowledge to the test. Everybody say that people be smart and people are knowledgeable and intellectual. So I'm gonna conduct myself very professionally. And we go bring forth the truth. So the whole debate is gonna be about, is Jesus God? That's the first debate that I wanna have. That's the topic of the debate that I wanna have with Visa. So I checked to see if he had his, if I got his email and his number. I didn't. I can't call him privately right now because my brother is not operational until he 100%, which I've never said that I didn't think that he would be 100%. I said that It's a possibility that he won't ever recover back to being the person he was, solely because of what's happening to him now. And he's not around his loved ones. There's a book out there that talks about recovery and how people are able to overcome traumatic injuries. And it showed how people needed moral support, spiritual support, and that it helped with people overcoming. I got to find that book, but it was a very good book. Hey, Alicia, Lano. Hey, Alicia. Amazing, Marla. Try to be somebody. Go get Trina. He has some questions. Okay. Go get Trina. Go get your favorite host. Get them over there. Send them the link. I'd like to say thank you to Trina. Trina donated several times on the I don't have an IG. Trina donated several times. My mom had a stroke, said she only got better because of us. That's right. My 10-year-old daughter suffered a stroke at 6 months old and severe concussion at 2 years old. So I get it, yeah. They need that moral support. It's a book out there that a doctor had written. And the doctor stated that it was most important that people had their families around and their loved ones around. And so that really helped out a lot. My favorite host, Pastor P and Journey. That's dope. Why Journey, Kay? Is this you on the screen? Why Journey? Love does it. My father was in a coma for 2 weeks and somebody was there every day until he woke up. That's right. Photo tags matter. Lano. Yeah, y'all calling me Lano. That's a family name. We need Trina. Where's Trina? Somebody else can get up here and ask a question. Don't be scared. Biscuit said that. Don't be scared. Don't be scared. Journey is extremely entertaining. I never seen anything Journey said. I seen her say a prayer for somebody, then cuss the hell out of people. I seen that. And you know what, ladies? I'm sorry to tell you that. The reason why I couldn't take it serious is because, where you at, Trina? You said you had questions. Because, ladies, let me tell you something. According to the Bible, you got to have your head covered when you pray. You got to have your head covered. You got to have, you know why the moms used to wear them big hats in church? They had to pray with their head covered. So I don't take serious women that don't pray with their head covered. They got to cover their heads. This is biblical. A man, I can't pray with my hat on. Keep them baby. Yeah, keep them goddamn babies out the street. Y'all funny because she and P have a genuine relationship. How genuine? Don't be spreading no rumors now. Queen K Canary. She is a tourist. I ain't worried about no tourist stuff. I do when my husband is at home. The Tommy Bomb Chef. Why did that randomly pop up in my head? Do you believe women can wear pants or not? Okay. When they say, so God said this in the Old Testament. He talked about women cannot wear things pertaining to a man, and men cannot wear things pertaining to a woman. Women wear scrubs to work. Women wear jeans. I'm gonna say this. I can't go against the word of God, so I'm gonna just say this. How I answer that question is, do you think a man should wear a dress? Do you think a wear should would you take a man wearing a dress? If y'all was to go out, do you think it would be cool for a man to wear a dress? Yes, it is. It is men clothing and women clothes. See, what happened was, so somebody said no. So if it's not good for us to wear a dress if we go out with you, why do you think you should wear pants? Right. I mean, it's simple. We cannot wear things that pertains to a woman. So now we in captivity now. So what I would say is this. See the Bible preaches that a woman should be modest in her apparel. Everything, the first thing that God fashioned was a woman, and he presented her to the man, right? Women can attract sensual desires from a man just based on the clothes that they wear. That should only be exclusive to your husband. That's why the people that's in these Muslim countries and in these Arab countries and in Israel, they cover their bodies, because that should be only exclusive to their husbands. And I think that's attractive. I think that a woman being discreet, well-spoken, I think that it when you show everything that you have, I think it tends to make you focus on just one thing about you. So that's why men get a lot of mixed signals when it comes to women, because of the simple fact that you're only looking at one thing. And men's desire, I don't care if you wearing jeans, tight jeans or something, and you walk into church, everybody is going to look at you. Everybody is going to look at you, right? Your attention, the Bible says, a woman should clothe herself in strength and honor. Right? A woman should clothe herself in strength and honor. God overemphasized a lot of times on how modest a woman's appearance is supposed to be, because men start to think of one thing when they look at you, when you show everything, you know. But if you cover yourself, then they have to explore the depths of who you are. And that's really what women really want, right? Women want a man who is going to love them for them. They don't just want to love them for what they see on the exterior. But when you show that, that's all they will want. And they don't want to get to know you as a person. So we do it wrong the first way, right? we do it wrong the first way because you want when you dress a certain way and you got your titties out, your ass out, and all this stuff out, you are attracting sexual desire, which every man or heterosexual man is going to be drawn to, and they're not going to look at the other things about you because of what you presented to them that may be desirous. So if you want a man to desire you for you, then you got to follow after what God said and be modest in your approach. She said she has some questions. Oh, Lady B, bring them up here. Bring them up. Pull up Red 39. All right. Just so you know the truth, Trina accused your brother of rape with no proof. Your brother hated him. But here you go allowing his ops to talk up. What do that have to do with me? What? That's Bigo stuff. That ain't got nothing to do with... That ain't got nothing to do with nothing else. That ain't got nothing to do with what I'm doing. Where my moderators at? Get them out of here. Throw them out. Lessons TV forever. Girl, that's Bigo shit. Yeah, I don't. That's why I don't get it. See, this is the reason why I don't get in Bigo, because then they bring that stuff to me. I have to deal with that if I'm on Bigo. But if I'm neutral, I ain't got to deal with it. I can say, I don't know nothing about that. See what I'm saying? TV killer. Shout out. You heard what TV killer, Tommy K said about you. Did you hear what she said about you? She be hating on you. Trina B here. Pick up the link, Trina B. She said all kind of stuff about you. She said you be posting all this crazy stuff about Keith and then OG murder. I ain't got nothing to do with that. That's why I stayed out of that. Eric, and another thing, look, this how they be so crazy. Look, everybody, OG murder used to kick it with Keith. Cuddy, Scout, Dale, all them people at one time was cool with Keith to some degree. Dale came out and said one day that when that incident happened with the bike, he was with Keith. So that's why I don't get into that. I'm on the personal side. You can't bring that to me. I'm neutral. I don't get into none of that stuff. Right? All money is green. Money don't say Cuddy on it. Money don't say Dale on it. Money don't say money got a white man's face on it. Money need be spent. That's it. I don't get into all of that. So I don't get into that. I don't get into all that mess. That's what goes on over there. They be trying to put me through all that stuff. I ain't got nothing to do with that. Me and my cousins, we don't know nothing about my auntie. We don't know nothing about that drama. We stay out of that. That's key business. All I know is today, at this time, we at 15:27:79. We at 15:27:79. Here we go. What's up?
What's up, Kevin? How are you, man? How are you?
Fantastic. How are you? I appreciate the donations. And I'm gonna shout it out because you have sent donations, and I really appreciate that. So respect to you.
Yeah, man, I was just a pleasure. You know, me and Keith had our issues as entertainers online, but in real life, this is a real life situation. It's called entertainment. And you know, we were doing things for entertainment. We was rivals as entertainment. It was not really personal, but some of his people took it personal, and that's the way things crumble. But you know, I knew Keith was two different men, as I would say. He was two different men. He was Pastor Patron and then Keith Jones. So, you know, and I understand where you're coming from. You didn't know Pastor Patron. Like, we knew Pastor Patron from Facebook. Right. I've been knowing Keith for like at least 7 or 8 years. You know, like,
okay,
like from Facebook to now. So it was a lot of things that were said and done, even on Facebook, you know, that a lot of people don't know about. You know, even when you got into it with him on, you know, when some of the things y'all got into about it was basically, he still was Pastor Patron at that time, because he tried to even do it with you, even though, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He tried to even do the Pastor Patron thing with you. So I was just going to come up and ask you some questions, because it was like some things that I noted that you said concerning your childhood, like some things I keep listening to. You said one of the questions I wanted to ask you was when you basically said to think about living with a demon, being raised by a demon. So how was that as a childhood, y'all dealing with stuff that I know you really have not talked about, or really you and Keith went through as a childhood when it comes to personally your mother, because your grandmother looked like she raised y'all. I mean, not really raised y'all, but took up the slack where your mother didn't have the ability to do what she needed to do.
Yeah. I did say that I was raised by my mom. She was a single parent. Now, she wasn't all bad. I couldn't say that. I think that, when my mom had me, she was 17, 18 years old. So, and I actually didn't forgive my mom for a lot of things until I turned 31 and I had my first daughter. So, I think that she did the best that she could do. And she came from she had a harsh background with her family. And it was difficult, the things that she went through, and she had to grow up just like a lot of young ladies nowadays that's not guided well. They have to go out there through trial and tribulation, and still they love their kids and they're gonna raise them to the best of their ability. But I can't say honestly that my mom is not all bad, but she lacked a lot of discretion in how she raised us. And when it came to her, I recall one time that I used to wait on my dad to come. My dad was infrequent in my life, but he was there because my grandmother I loved. My mom lived with my grandmother, and that was on my dad's side, Brenda. And I used to wait on my dad to come. And I recall at one time my mom calling me a devil because I was waiting on my dad. But the history of that was her and my dad was high school sweethearts, and he had cheated on her with her best friend. And so my father had a son, which is a brother that's under me on my dad's side, by my mom's best friend. And so when my mom looked at me, I felt like she looked at me because I looked just like my dad. And she looked at me like I was my dad sometimes, and she kind of blamed me because I didn't take it at that time like that, because I couldn't understand why she would call me a devil because I was waiting on my dad, you know. But I guess she was upset about the relationship that happened, and you know, that just happens with young ladies that never got over their first love, and my dad was her first love. So I probably took it at that time like it was evil, and which it was, because I didn't understand the intricate details about their relationship until I got older and I found out all the things that happened. Then I found out how my dad was, and I never blamed him for who he was, but you know, that's what happened. That just it set a course on me and her relationship. And I think that's why there's a lot of division right now, because when she see me, it's like she see my dad, because my dad was her first love. And my dad had broken her heart because he was with her best friend. So it's easy for me to take it that way. I don't know the intricate details of everything that went on at that time, but I know that they were high school sweethearts, and there was something that happened before that that I don't want to talk about that at this point in time, which is an even bigger issue to maybe contributing why my mom may look at me a certain way as opposed to my brother. So, yeah, she was tough. My mom was like my older brother. I recall when I was in California, me and my brother stayed in California, and I had gotten into a fight with some guys at the park, because I was good at basketball when I was young, and some guys tried to jump on me because, you know, I was showing out on them. I went home and I told my mom what happened, and she saw the bruises. She put a knife in her pocket. She went up there to try to fight. My mom been a tomboy and tough ever since she was young. So, and she was writing for us at times, but I think now it's like she look at things a different way now, because we older and we are opinionated. We have our own ways, and she don't have a certain level of control over us now. And so, you know, she probably I just think that we look at it a certain way, like it's evil, and it is. It's evil, but it's all about understanding where people come from too. Oh, I lost you. I lost you. So yeah, that's what happened with my mom. When he come up, I'll bring him up again. But my mom was always tough. My mom was a tomboy. You know, she not no punk. You know, she's tough. And she has been there for us at times, when we needed her to be there at times. But she just don't, I think my mom just don't know how to love properly. That's what it is. You know, she was raised in a dysfunctional family, and there was challenges that she had to overcome within her own family. And so, and she felt neglected at times, and she had to run off from her mom to be with my dad's mom in order to raise me and rear me the way that, you know, she the best that she could, because she didn't have a good relationship with her mom. But okay, let me drop the link again. So hold on. Okay, this is so that's what happened. I'm trying to keep it as short as possible, but there's a lot of family rooted things that is the reason why people's outcome is the way that it is. And I'm trying to change the dynamics of our family, in my own family, in my nuclear family. I was raised around a lot of domestic violence. I was raised around a lot of drugs. I was raised around a lot of dysfunction, a lot of hate. And I think in so many ways, you see all of those things in Pastor P. In the videos that I saw, I see all those things. If it's not dealt with, it will breed dysfunction, right? That's the best thing that I can say about that. When you grow up, I'm gonna bring you up in a minute, Trina B. When you grow up in a certain environment, if you don't cut the things that that really are dysfunctional and you don't deal with it, you tend to acclimate that to your lifestyle and your life choices. And it's not because that's what you want, but maybe because you just don't know how to deal with it. The only way I was able to deal with it is through God. So that's what I can explain about my mother's relationship. It has everything to do with the fact that she did not change the dynamics of the generational curse that came as a result of her dysfunction and with not dealing with her family issues and her childhood and the trauma that she went through. And this kind of got into Keith because Keith didn't have another avenue. Keith didn't want to have a relationship with his dad. I had a relationship with my other side of the family, but Keith never had that. So he had to navigate through these things vicariously through my mom's experiences and through the way that we grew up. He had no other outlet and he just did the best that he could do. That's the only thing I can explain about that. And it's demonic. Those generational curses, it can get into everybody. And the hardest thing that it's been for me is to change the dynamics of everything that's happened. I feel the weight of responsibility coming on me from my past and where I want to be in the future, right? And so it takes a strong person. It really takes God, literally, or a very strong person to cut ties to some of the things that your family do that's dysfunctional, that contributed to a certain mindset that will continue into your children and your children's children until you are able to cut it off. So I wasn't trying to be long, but...
Yeah, but I realize hurt people hurt people.
Absolutely.
And I'm really praying for y'all relationship to get better, because it's nothing like that bond to have a mother that truly loves you, because I had a mother. And you was not fortunate to have that, but I really had a mother that truly loved me. So I understand. I don't understand some of the things that you may be going through, or Keith may be going through, or anybody may be going through, because my mother was my rock, you know, and still is my rock. You know, sometimes I can only imagine how my life would be if it was not for my mother, you know what I mean? Without my mother. So, you know, but I really understand where you're coming from, because everybody is not fortunate enough to have a good mother, a good role model. In your life, and it's called dysfunction. But and I'm glad.
Let me add something to that real quick, Trina B, because it's very important. Nobody can underestimate the amount of pressure it puts on a man when he don't have the love from his mother. Mm-hmm. That is very vital. All the mothers in here, let me tell you something. It's very important that you love your children. Very important. Mothers are, I mean, Jesus had a mother that loved him. I lived on this earth for 44 years and I contemplate whether my mother loves me. That's the saddest thing in the world for any man, because a man wants to make his mother proud. A man wants to buy, the first thing some of these NBA players and professional athletes do when they get money, the first thing they think about is their mom. Let me go buy her a house. Let me go buy her a car. And just the fulfillment that you get and the gratification that you get from putting that love into your mom, it just puts you on cloud nine. Mm-hmm. And for your mom to be there at critical stages, when you graduate, dads ain't always there. But listen to this. I grew up in a single parent home. My mom was the only thing that we had. She was the only thing that we had. So when you feel like you're not loved by your mom, that is a very traumatizing experience. You can't even go to her. And then everything that you look for in a female, you try to base everything based off the relationship that you had with your mother. But if you had a strained relationship with your mother, how you gonna treat all the women that you know? You can, that's the first person you got to trust. So why you got to go out here through trial and error? And that's the reason why a lot of young men go out here trying to find the wrong women, because they got a strained relationship with their mother. So I just had to implement that while you were talking, because what you said is very profound. Having a good relationship with your mom is very important. No matter what choices that you make in your life, your mom should be there to say, son, I don't care who you are, what you choose to do in your life, I'm always going to be a staple in your life, and I'm always going to love you. I didn't have that.
Yeah. And I understand that. And you know what? And you know, you knew this about your brother. What saddened me about your brother at times is that, you know, we were roasting and we were doing things, but his relationship with God was my issue. Just like you probably had your issue with him concerning that too, his relationship with God, that he, I believe he knew God. I mean, he knew God, but he just didn't believe in God. He knew God, but he just didn't believe in. I used to always say, Pastor P, I mean, Keith at the time, I said, because he used to go against some of the exact things that, is somebody coming up?
Yeah, I got him parked. It's okay. I got them. I'm a bring you up. No cash. Hold on. I'm gonna let Trina B finish his point.
Yeah. But what I was saying that I had a problem with his relationship with God, because some things he was blaspheming, like he always used Jesus' name in vain, and I was always Keith, you got to be careful with that. I said blaspheming can cause your life, you know what I'm saying? I used to be clear with him, but man, by him disagreeing with me on a line, it was always, you know, I guess I was not the person to tell him at the time, or he would listen to. But thank God that you were still around to tell him. Somebody was still able to tell him. And some of the things I would say, and I agree with you, God had to cut the head for the tail to die in that situation. As you see, some of these people are cult like minded people that followed him. So, So not that Keith really, I don't really think he really paid attention to that or really realized who was following him. So a lot of that was like nerve wracking to me, because I seen a disaster coming. You know, I always tell him this, a disaster is going to happen. It's going to happen. Although we all sin and we come short of the glory of God. We all, I got my flaws, but one thing, I'm a strong believer in Christ, and we may have our disagreements as brothers in Christ on certain scriptures, certain things, but can be debatable. But the foundation is you know who Jesus is. Jesus is real. He's the Alpha and the Omega. God is the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's Son, His only begotten Son, to save a dying world. So I'm a true, strong believer in God. I mean, I'm not where I used to be, and where I should be, but I'm not where I used to be. So,
but that's okay, Trina B, because what I would say to you is this: all of us are a work in progress. Mm-hmm. If we had it all, it would be no need for us to study and learn. Mm-hmm. It's very important that we understand as believers in God is that it's not an expectation that we are perfect. It's an expectation that we are learning, and we are trying to acclimate ourselves with truth. Right. Mm-hmm. It's important, very vital, that we don't go by what we believe in and of ourselves, because there would be no need for the word. The word gives us understanding of how we are to conduct ourselves and how we are to navigate ourselves in life. So my only thing when it comes to everybody is that making sure that whatever position that you have with God, it's aligned with His word, right? That's the only thing that I say. I'm never in a position to judge one from the standpoint of just their own choices in life. The only thing that I come out and say is, what does the word says? What does the word say? That's the single most important thing. If we understand what God says and we go by the authority of the word, we can't go wrong in any of our choices. He is the GPS. He navigates us to the destination of our ultimate end. And that's where we should be centered on, not on our own thoughts, on our own wishes, or what we think is right in the world. It has to be centered on what God says. So it's not up to me to judge anyone. It's for me to present the facts of what the Lord says and go by what the word says and leave it up to you. You have volition. You have a choice to make. God has given us a choice to make, and every opportunity that he gives us on this earth, when you wake up, you better make sure that it aligns with what the word says, because that is what you will be judged on.
Yeah.
And so when it comes to Keith, Keith, we have had numerous conversations about God. I recall one time when he stayed on Scottwood, where he made this video that I just showed in the introduction. We were going back and forth, and it was so loud downstairs that my aunt called from upstairs and said, "Hey, what's going on down there? What is y'all doing? Y'all sound like y'all about to fight." We have had exchanges about this God, and people have to be prepared and ready to assume the righteousness that God has for them, but they have to make a choice, and Keith was not prepared to make that choice. So what do God do? When you're not going to listen to the word, when you're not going to listen to people, there will be an event that would happen as a result that may cause you a serious injury. It may even cause your life. So I look at this as a blessing for Keith, because it gives him an opportunity to align himself with truth and with righteousness. And sometimes if it has to get that far for God to reach you, you know how far away you are. And not only that, when you are leading people and you are at the level that he is, the way that the people I talk to, I can't even believe some of the things that people say to me. And I'd be like, wow.
If you could only imagine, imagine if Keith was a God-fearing man and the flock wow. led to God. Just man. Imagine, just imagine all the people that flocked to him and was following him. You know how many people he could have led to God. Like I said, God is a jealous God, and we got to see it for what it is. And I know you've seen it too, as you probably seen it. And I always tell people, they saying God didn't have nothing to do with this. God had a lot to do with it. He had a whole bunch to do with it because of how it happened. And stuff like this just don't automatically happen. You got to be spiritual to understand who God is. Some things don't happen just because. It was a reason why God did it, and God allowed it to happen. Allowed it to happen. And if you look at everything that transpired, because we would have never knew the God that was filming Keith. The God that was filming him.
Uh-huh.
The God that was filming him, we never knew him. Nobody never knew him. He was just a random guy that was from Toledo, Ohio. Who would have ever known that at that particular time he would have been filming Keith at that particular time? Because nobody didn't know. I didn't want to believe it, even though, you know, I didn't want to believe it because I seen him on the ground, but I seen him, but when I looked on the ground, it didn't look like it, because the jeans that he had on, shoes that he had on, it just didn't match. It just was not my vision of who Keith was, you know, of who I seen. So I blocked it out of my head until I got a second confirmation it was really him. And when the confirmation came, I was really hurt and really devastated, because although me and him had our flaws and people thought we was much enemies, it just the human nature of empathy and sympathy you're gonna have instantly if you love God. You're gonna have that instantly for all humankind. There's nothing you're going to it's just gonna come over you. And some people can't understand that about me. They call that flip-flopping or or fake or whatever like that. It's not fake. It's just who I really is. I mean, who I am really in real life. But as entertainment, they may think something else.
Right.
They can't distinguish the two. Because I'm also an actor, so it's like they don't know they can't see the two differences, and they don't know Keith from Pastor Patron. They can't separate the two. Same thing with him. They can't separate the two.
Absolutely. So you go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So and that's the sad part, that it's a lot of people that will follow him wasn't even looking at him as a sex object. Was looking at him for what they can get. They would never tell him when he was wrong. You know, like people around you and condone everything you do, but you ain't got no checks and balances. That was what was wrong with Keith. He didn't have nobody, the followers telling him the truth, you know, you may hit a brick wall, reel yourself back. Don't do this and don't do that. I thank God for some of my followers, because they tell me. They check me. So I got a check and balances when it comes to my supporters, because I allow them to do that. I allow my people to be an open book. If I do something wrong, please tell me. You know, don't let me, I don't even want no friends around me that's going to allow me to bump my head when I'm doing
wrong. Right. Yeah. I can't have no friends like that either. I want checks and balances. And you also have to be at a point where you can receive that information as well. It's not so much putting pressure on other people to tell you, but they may love you so much or may care about you so much that they don't want to hurt your feelings, or they don't want to sabotage the image that you portray on what it, like you said, this is a it blurs the lines of real life and the character sometimes.
Yes.
Because even though you are in character or it may be a play or something, it's still you. Right? It's nobody else. It's still Trina B at the end of the day.
Yes.
So let's not get that twisted. So a lot of people don't have strong minds. They can't really acknowledge that this is what I do as a job or for a hobby or for entertainment, and not me personally. So Keith was good at blurring the lines when it came to that. See what I'm saying? So it wasn't always about per se him. It was maybe the people, and in fact, don't have the strong minds to be able to, you know, understand that this is just somebody that, you know, do this for a hobby or whatever, right? I don't know if I lost you. But it was somebody else that came up, no cash. I think you had a question. I don't know if I lost Trina B. You still there, Trina? You might come up again. But a lot of people really can't separate the two. And that's a great travesty when we're not able to separate the two and look at it like this is the person and this is entertainment, because a lot of people take that stuff serious. They take that stuff serious. I mean, I talked to some people that I thought they knew him better, like they was raised with us. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was just blown away by some of these fans or some of these people that came in and was talking on Tommy K's page. So it was serious. They take it serious, and I'm like, wow, you really think this is the real person? I just couldn't understand it. And even at this time, a lot of things that Keith said when he was upset at me, they don't understand. That wasn't really true. A lot of that stuff is not true. Right? But people went and took what was said and ran with it like it was the gospel truth. And I was like, dang. Dang. Okay, 1,000 a day. Swear seal. That's the link, Trinity B. I want to get other people up here to ask questions as well. I'm gonna make sure I talk to Trina B because he's been donating and supporting the cause for Keith. But
and you know, you know what I tell people all the time. They always calling people out, but an op ain't gonna a person that really hates somebody is not going to pour no money into nothing concerning this guy. But right. You are in true heart to really do some things. And the reason why I gave my donation to you because I saw that you were responsible and accountable for where the money is going, and accountability right. A lot to me. If I'm gonna put right. My money in somebody and something and somebody care or somebody that's been a big brother, it matters because he's a big broadcaster. He's a big
right.
So it matters. Accountability matters regardless of what people say and how people say believed. All this I don't want. I don't need to know, and I don't need to know what's going on. Everybody needs to know. And that's how you're going to get more money. That's how you're
absolutely
going to from people that you wouldn't even expect right. to give money because it's accountability. Keith is no longer Pastor Patron no more. He's Keith Jones dealing with real life issues. He's not no longer Pastor Patron, not to ever say he's will ever come back. I don't really believe he's coming back to that. Mm-hmm. Not the way I know who God is. If God did such a traumatic thing and saved your life, I don't believe he would want to come back.
No, not like the person that he was.
Yeah.
I think that if you could see him the way that he is, I think that taps on a human's heart because even Dale said, now Dale was, we know him to be a nemesis of Keith. And whether he is or not, he still said, hey, go and support what Kevin is doing, you know, because he see it. And, you know, I mean, when you out the game, you out the game, you know, it's, you know, but to be truthful, a lot of the content that you guys have, Keith brought more content to that environment. And everybody would say, by consensus, everyone would say, regardless of who he was, he brought more attention to that app in that environment, in you guys' environment, than anything. You know, and every one of you got your own ways of doing things, and you got your own characteristics and your pull to your viewers or supporters, but having him there is an advantage to Beagle. It really is, because it brings content, it brings something to talk about. So that revenue that was coming in, when you get down to it, Trina, it's about the money. It comes down to the money. Where everybody is trying to make money. This don't mean that we like, it may not be the way we are in real life, but it comes down to bringing in supporters and building your support network and making money, which I'm not against. Now, as far as the ethics that's involved and the things that I think is too traumatic on me psychologically, you know what I'm saying? For me, I think you guys are some of the strongest people that I've ever seen to have to endure all these things. And there are certain emotions that comes with dealing with that environment as well. That's real. When we cut off that camera and we go back to our normal lives and we have to raise our children or be involved with our families, we're coming back to real life. And I don't want us to miss the essence of that. The understanding of that when we cut off these cameras and we log off and we go to our normal lives, we have to deal with whatever that's coming up, what's going on in our real lives. And some of this stuff can be very difficult to deal with.
Yeah, it can be so difficult to deal with because, you know, I've been swatted. I've been, people don't came to my mom's house. I'm telling some things I didn't think. Some of the things that I didn't think was whatever happened. You know, I didn't think that people were that vicious until I really got into the entertainment part of this app. I never thought that I would be even saying some of the things I had to say.
Mm-hmm.
Back at some people, you know, like I mean, I've had to say some foul, vicious stuff to people. But then I had to go back and realize that, you know, I had to be nervous. After I say stuff, I'm nervous because I know karma is something. I know
right.
it's real. So I'm nervous, like, God, please, Lord, have mercy on me. This just, you know.
Right, right.
I'm nervous because I know what karma can cause, you know.
Yeah.
And it can affect you. It can affect your whole family. It can affect your children. It can, I mean, you know, people that you love. It's not only just you. So I understand that sometimes this app is a Beagle. There's nothing like now another app on it is.
I swear. I've never seen anything like it. I wanted to ask you a question, though. How do you deal with that, though? How do you deal with because I seen you get real, real mad about, sir, especially when it came to your son and that whole debacle with your son. How did that impact the way you looked at this environment?
It really got down deep down to me, but the most important, that really didn't really bother me as much as me being swatted. You know, like the police, me opening the door and police gun blazing at me, putting me on the ground, humiliating me, and doing all that. And then to find out, when I listened to the tape, to find out who done it was even worse. I'm talking about, you know, and you go back and you said you don't ever want to go back like you used to. You start thinking about, I had got to the point that I even wanted that person murdered. You know, mm-hmm. like, I'm talking about, you don't ever know what your mind will you after you see a person all the time and they digging at you. I really want that person, really something to happen to that person. And so many, if it was not in Keith, the situation with Keith, actually changed me. That situation changed my thoughts and my mind. Wow. It made me think to forgive, you know.
Twice,
you
got,
I have been so far gone. If it was not for that, I think I would have been in the same situation. Sometimes it take things like that sometimes to check you.
Mm-hmm. I completely understand that.
It checked me. It broke me down to the point that God's grace, Lord, is because it could have been me. It could have been you. It could have been my children. It could have been me. But Lord, it was your grace and mercy that it was not me. You still gave me another chance.
Mm-hmm.
When a family is grieving now, a family is going through it, because at that particular time, nobody knew if Keith was going to live or die. So, you know, so that was my biggest thing. And so many people don't have empathy and sympathy at a time. It's okay to joke and argue, but some people don't even give nobody no room to breathe. And they rat on their neck when somebody dies, when somebody get hurt. That's not a part of me. I cannot do that, even in entertainment. You know, and even out there, I've said something to a lot of stuff to the church to piss them off. You know, the church women and the church, the people piss them off concerning Keith, but it's on the end. I know I'm going to get to them. But I knew I was going to get to them.
Right.
You know, to him, I knew I was going to get to them. So they would trigger me and I'll say something just to trigger them. You know,
right.
Just to
right.
them, because I know he's their God. You know, to some of them, that they got. And when I used to tell them, he ain't never come. Oh, baby, you ought to see me. I used to tell them, he ain't never coming back. Tell y'all, God, this is for, he ain't never coming back. I mean, I used to dig at them. He ain't never, they just get angry. I'm talking about furious. Oh, you need to do this. Your kids need to die. I said, he ain't never coming back to y'all because all y'all did was try to use him for a sexual object. Y'all want for him. Y'all don't love him. Y'all don't do this. And I used to always come at them. But you ever heard the truth sometimes hurt, even though you joking about it or even doing it. But sometimes the truth hurts, and the truth was hurting them because they knew they mind what they don't want. They didn't want that man there because of because they want him healed. They want him there because they want there for their own personal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I saw that too because I didn't know how severe it was until somebody had wrote me and they said, yeah, I watch your brother every day while I'm at work. I watch your brother. He's helped me get through my addiction. And it wasn't all bad things, but I was saying like, damn, where is God at?
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, well, what is Jesus doing? Yeah. And I think that even when I think about the accident and the fact that, cause I drive by Somerset where he was, where the accident was, and it was right in front of a church. And, you know, that's what I was going to talk about here later on, because I was telling them that, I know who is responsible for everything that's going on.
And God is amazing. He allowed that to happen right in front of a church. Right, exactly in front of a church.
Absolutely.
If you are not spiritual and don't understand who God is, some people would never understand it. They would never understand who God is because he did it in such a way. And then he had to openly expose Keith when he was on the ground, because you know why? Because he was an internet person, so the internet had to catch
right
that part had to be exposed because of who God is. He said, God don't, one thing I know about God,
absolutely,
if you don't know, and one thing about it, and but those that that's in Christ that know him, we know when it's God, but people that's not, don't know God, don't know when it's God. They don't know when it's him. They don't know when it's truly him. So, you know, some things happen and it's Satan. And some things happen, it's a divine purpose by God. Some things is totally happen when it's God in it.
And it's always God, because if you go back to the story and you read about David and what happened with Bathsheba and the fact that David had looked over his roof and he saw Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, in the shower, and he told his servants to go and get her and bring her here. And he conceived a child with her, and God held him responsible for what he did. And he said, the sword would never leave your house because of what you did to your servant Uriah, who has served you faithfully in that army. He wouldn't go back to his wife when David was trying to provoke him to go back to his wife, because he knew he had impregnated that woman that was married to him. And he sent him out in the front line to fighting the war. And they ended up pushing him to the front and he got killed, right? And so when David went into exile, the prophet Nathan had told him that he had did something wrong and God had saw him. And do you know what he did as a result of him doing what he did to Uriah with Bathsheba? He had his son Absalom sleep with his wives in the public on the roof, the same roof where he looked down and saw Uriah's wife and brought her in. God is capable of making an example out of you, and he will do it publicly. And I've seen videos where Keith has said things publicly. So it was only fitting that if you reap what you sow sooner than you sow, later than you sow, that God is going to do it before the public. He's going to do it before the public. You said this stuff in Jesus' name, what you was going to do? Okay. The Bible says he won't hold anyone guiltless that uses his name in vain. And that's exactly what he did to Keith. I believe that God is, like they say, if it's evil in the city, it's God that did it. It says it in Amos. It's God that done it. If he's omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent, and sovereign above every authority, then that means whatever has happened, it happened through the, it had to go through the hands of God first, right? And so that is exactly what we saw in this situation. You can't play with God, because God will show you out. He said, be careful that your sin don't find you out. And it will, in the worst way, when you least expect it. And this was a time when I talked to my brother when we were fishing. A lot of people don't know that I even saw a maturity in him. This is when he was trying to get it right. And, you know, it was like God told me when I sat next to him and I was looking at him and we were driving in his van. It was like, you're not going to see him like this again for a while. That's what I felt when I was with him. You're not going to see him like this again. And it wasn't a coincidence that I was the person that was with him the day before his accident. And I was supposed to be out there on the 7th. I didn't go out there with him on the 7th. And it wasn't meant for me to be there. And then this traumatic incident happened. And it happened on the very same day that the person that got into the accident, when I tore up the bike, even though I didn't tear up the bike, it was a close family member of mine that was on that took the bike and ran off of the bike. And end up crashing the bike on they crashed the bike on the very same day, 3 years prior.
He went off on me
at that time. Keith has never talked to me like that. He has never talked to me like that. And I still got the text message in my phone when he said, I'm about to go live on you. I'm about to say all kind of crazy. I was pissed, but I was like, I ain't even bothered with you. I ain't gonna mess with you. I'm concerned about my cousin, man. My cousin was hurt from that accident. They almost died. So I had to deal with the trauma of that incident and deal with my brother that I love that was saying these vicious things to me. And I was just like, I couldn't understand it. I was just like, and then this year, it was the same thing. It's the same thing that happened. And we were getting ready to get, you know why I didn't pay for the bike? I'll be truthful. And this is the first time I'm going to say this. The reason why I didn't pay for the bike, because we was getting the insurance together to go ahead and pay for the bike to get fixed. I told him, fuck you. You go get on here and talk to me crazy in front of all these people and wishing people go die. I said, man, I ain't giving you a goddamn thing. You go pull up on, try to act like you go pull up on me and do something to me, nigga, you crazy. I ain't giving you nothing. I told them, don't even worry about it. I ain't giving him nothing. That's what I said. That's what happened at that time. And he was coming over to my house a couple of days later after that situation. He came over there on his new bike. The bike he got in the accident with, I seen that bike. He came over to my house with that very same bike. And he came over there because the bike that I had messed up was in my driveway. It was in my driveway, so he had to come to me, and it was in my name. He had to come to me to get the title, and he had to come to me to get the bike. So that's when I knew all of that was just for Bigo stuff. But I didn't understand what Bigo was at that time. I didn't understand or what Facebook was or whatever he was on at that time. I didn't understand it. But I knew that, you know, and then it's the very same video that they pick up when my brother get into an accident, was the video that he was mad at me. And you know how you are when you emotional, when you mad. You say things that you wouldn't normally say under normal circumstances. And I knew, even though it pissed me off, because I had seen him several times, and my brother he not gonna fight me. I don't care what nobody, these people don't know Keith personally. He wasn't gonna do nothing. He had plenty of opportunity to do it. And he never did. I walked to the back with him thinking that we was going to get into it when I was showing him the bike, and he never said nothing. He took the bike. He took it to his house or whatever. We didn't talk for a while after that, and he was upset about it. But, you know, it was a done deal, and we never talked about it after that. Even when I was with him fishing on the 6th of June of this year, we never even talked about none of that stuff. And it was a lot of things that happened that I did not post, that if I did, if I did, if I really wanted to be nasty or be a jealous brother like they say I am, if I posted this shit, I guarantee it'll be embarrassing towards Keith. I guarantee it would. And I never did. I still got videos in my phone that nobody has ever seen. I got the video of Ghost and Keith playing dominoes in my phone. And I ain't never posted it or never said anything about it. I can't hear you. I can't hear you, Trina B. I don't think your thing is... Hold on. Let me see. I can't hear you. Can you hear me? Where's no cash at? No cash. Come up on the screen again. I know you've been trying to talk to me. I'm going to put this out here. Trina B, I'm going to get some questions in by No Cash because he's been trying to. Okay, I'm going to put it up for you. All right. Pin the link that I did it, y'all. Okay. That's the link. All right. All right. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, can you hear me? Yeah, I can hear you. All right, give me 1 second, bro. I'm about to go. Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, give me 1 quick second. I'm going downstairs. Because I don't want everybody to hear my business.
Okay. Give me 1 second. I got to step over here and get something real quick. I hear you, though.
Okay. All right, how can I? Am I right? Am I set up right? Because I don't know how to work none of this stuff. I'm going to set up right. Everything good?
Yeah, I can see you.
All right. I just want to say peace and love to you, brother. Why I'm hearing an echo of myself?
It might be me. I don't know. Or it might be you turned up on your volume, but I can hear you clear as day. Trina B, I'm gonna get to you. I gotta get other people at Red 39.
I'm gonna turn my volume all the way down.
Okay, go ahead. But I can hear
okay,
you.
Okay, well, this is all I wanted.
I can't hear you now.
Okay,
go ahead.
You can hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you.
All right, listen, bro. I just wanted to... You can't hear me?
I can't hear you. I can hear you. Yeah, I hear you.
Damn, that's crazy. It's like, it's like I'm talking over myself. It's like, okay, you can hear me though. All right, say no more. Yo, this is all I want. What I want to say to you is this, man. This situation is a very touchy one for me because I went through the same situation as you and Keith, but it was me and my sister. And I'm the oldest. I'm the oldest of my siblings, just like you. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting back watching how delicate you're trying to deal with this situation, considering it's your mom that's in charge. You know the dynamics of your mom and your brother's relationship as well. And you don't understand the Beagle situation. Like I'm sitting back looking at this saying, how's this guy gonna do with this thing? Like, is he gonna handle it the right way? And bro, when I saw you start pulling out the Bible and saying that you was gonna let God lead you, I said, okay, finally somebody that's talking about God and prayer, the Most High, who can make a difference in something. Finally, somebody who's talking about what matters. So I was watching you for a minute, and bro, no lie, you really astonished me, because all my life being the older brother, I had to stand in the gap against my mama a lot of times. And I'm gonna be honest with you, my grandmama and my granddaddy, the only two people that could check my mama, that could she'll tame herself in the presence of them. But when they passed away, nobody couldn't tell my mama nothing. And she's the baby of 8 siblings. The oldest brother and the oldest sister could do nothing with my mama. Now, I love my mama. I don't bash my mama. And I'm sick of even explaining the dynamics of how much I love my mama, like I know you love your mama.
Mm-hmm.
See, I explained it to people like this. People tell us that the greatest love that you can experience is from parents to kids, but that's a lie. The greatest love you will ever experience is from kids to parents. Kids don't have no choice but to love their parents. You can whip your child ass. You can mistreat the child. You can fucking talk shit to the child. They're going to wake up the next day wishing and hoping that you be the loving, kind mother or father that they know you should be.
Right.
And so I understand that you love your mama, man. You don't got to fin and prove that the people on here so much. I wanted to share that with you, because here's the thing. People with loving parents or loving mother, if you will, they'll never understand life from my perspective or your perspective. And I'm going to include myself with you, because I don't know your mama, bro. And I ain't here to judge your mama, because I don't judge my own mama.
Right.
I wish like hell, right, that my mother was the loving, nurturing, kind, submissive mother that I know mothers should be. Not even mothers, man. Dogs, animals are just mothers. They know how to be a mother. It's an innate thing that's inside of them that they know how to do that shit, okay? And so as a son, I looked for that in my mom all my life. And it bothered me when I didn't get it. So I can understand your frustration. But I wanted to tell you something, bro, because when I found this, it helped me be able to come to terms with who my mama really is and why she did what she did. And you know who your mama really is. You know why she did what she did. You explained it tonight. You told me a little bit. I didn't even know the thing you said tonight. But when you was like, my daddy sex her best friend and had a baby, I was like, ooh. You see, so I feel your mama's pain, but it's still no excuse. Not talking about your mama. I'm talking about any of us, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I be hearing people say, in the comment section about Keith, they'll say, I have a hard time believing that God put that accent. Huh? You were saying something?
No, I didn't. Okay, I'm listening to you.
I be reading in your comment section where people say they have a hard time believing that it was God that designed or orchestrated what happened to Keith, right?
Uh-huh.
People are having a hard time understanding that. But let me tell y'all how we know. I'm not saying God made that happen to Keith, because God don't make nothing happen to none of us. He made us creatures of choice.
Right.
He created us with the power to say, I will or I will not. He didn't make us serve him, okay? So we choose to sin or live righteous, right?
Right.
And sometimes we choose to sin willfully and knowingly, and sometimes we sin and we don't know what we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
God don't fault you when you don't know what you're doing. But when you know what you're doing, I don't care whether it's acting in the name of acting, in the name of playing a game, shoo-shooing and bull jiving around, whatever it is. You have to be careful how you play, because art imitates life and life imitates art. That's right. How it works.
Right.
And okay, your brother Keith, I don't know the Keith guy. I know Pastor P. And I don't really even know him, right? I'm gonna be honest with you. I'm gonna give him his props, because what I know about him is that he's the king of that app over there, that Bigo app, right? I'm a YouTuber. You know, I see you over here working on YouTube. I say I'm gonna come over here and try to get. I wanted to talk to you, but I didn't know how. And now you didn't open up a floor. You doing something with YouTube, bro, that I don't even know how to do. And I got a YouTube button. Look, I got a whole YouTube button, and you work in YouTube better than me. Now, I'm just telling you, keep doing what you're doing, because it ain't falling on deaf ears. And I know what you're up against when it comes to your, like, trying to do what's best for your brother and having your brother's best interest at heart and standing in the gap. And I'm saying it against your mom, but it's not even against your mom, but this is what you're up against. We just got to talk the truth about it, right?
Right.
And I know your concern as far as you wouldn't want your brother's, all of the responsibility of your brother to be on your mama, considering y'all circumstances and y'all upbringing.
Right.
And bro, I'm just saying to you, keep doing what you're doing and keep fighting that good fight, because a lot of people on Bigo ain't gonna understand what you're doing, bro. Because a lot of them had loving and kind and nurturing mothers and stuff like that. And I'm not saying that they had perfect mothers, right?
Right.
They didn't have perfect mothers, but I can relate to what the dynamics is that you went through with your mother. And you ain't told me nothing. I heard your brother talk about your mom a lot of times. And it made me think, I even thought one or two things. I said, this dude either went through some crazy things with his mom, or he just don't like his mama. But I knew he didn't just don't like his mama, because all kids love their parents. Yeah. I just couldn't put my finger on why he felt the way he felt. But right. You bring all of that understanding, bro, with what you're doing for him. You can't even make it understood with what you're saying. Your actions is speaking louder than anything that you will ever be able to say.
Right.
And nobody knows what you up against like you. So don't get lost in the perception of these people and their opinions and trying to do what they think is right. Because a lot of them don't even understand the dynamics of what you're dealing with. You just got to keep praying and keep putting God first and doing what you know is the righteous thing with righteous intent. And you're going to be all right, bro.
I appreciate that. Absolutely. And we do share that. I heard what you said on my community, and I really respect that. And everything that you're saying is consistent with the things that I'm dealing with right now. And people don't really understand what it's like to have a mother like this. And I'm not saying it to be facetious or to put her down or to be condescending. It's more so to hold her accountable. I think that's our responsibility. And I think that's the only way that people will change is if you hold them accountable for the things that they do and not be their cheerleading squad when they're doing the wrong thing. The Bible clearly tells us that when you know something is wrong and you do it anyway, that's sin in and of itself. So I'm not going to allow that to continue, because I think that's what's permeating our society right now, is that we don't hold people accountable when they do things. And so that's what contributes to them continuing in that spiraling way of life that's going into the wrong direction. And what I'm doing is holding my mom accountable, because I see two people that's injured spiritually. Not just one, two. It's my mom and it's my brother. And I've never been in a position to really correct my brother about certain things, because he wouldn't listen. You know, he was the breadwinner to so many people. So when they say they love God and they put God at first and they go to church and then they depending on him, he gonna be like, well, damn, I'm feeding them. You know what I'm saying? God ain't feeding them. I'm feeding them. So I think that feeds into this mindset that he has when it relates to this issue with God, because he's saying that he's feeding people who believe in God. So how can he be real? And we dealing with a person who has questions about God's existence. So I really want to commend you for coming out and speaking your piece on this. I have to get to other people, and I appreciate what you're saying, and I'm going to open up the panel more for you to come on, but I do want to tell you I appreciate everything that you're saying, brother, and I empathize with your situations and as well as you empathize with mine, and I'm going to continue to stand in the gap as much as I can and continue to do what I'm doing. So this is just about the well-being, not just of myself and Keith, but our family and our community in general, and everybody that's impacted by this situation. So I want to thank you for coming out and speaking and saying your piece in this. So that's where I stand with it. Thank you for coming and speaking out. And I got some other questions from other people, and I'm going to bring them up on the panel. If you don't have anything else to say, that's where I am with that. Appreciate it, brother.
Appreciate that. Appreciate it. I just want to say in closing, I'm going to be around this situation because God had a calling on my life about this same situation. And I'm explaining it to you on another level or off of the camera and show you some stuff that can really open your eyes to what I'm trying to say. But I'm going to be here coexisting around this situation, bro, because when I say I commend you, I really do, man. And I know what you up against. And I know how it feels in the position that you're in. Just stand strong, stand firm, and keep fighting the good fight. Because it ain't going to be easy. But God gives his toughest battles to his strongest soldiers. And you strong, though. You strong, man. And so I can hear the strength in you when you're talking. And it ain't like you know it all. You don't have all the answers. But just move forward with righteous intent and you're going to be all right. Because I see a lot of things have been moved already out your way, man. Mm-hmm. And people might come to you and tell you something about me, but I don't know your brother. I don't know you. And I don't know them Beagle people. I just got on Beagle like 2 years ago. But your brother did have a little beef with me, right? It wasn't a beef that. It was a Beagle beef. Like you say, I don't know shit about the Beagle shit. He came at me. But I separated Pastor Pete from Keith Jones when you came to the situation and started talking about this shit from a realistic perspective. I cannot continue to act like I had a problem with this guy because I don't even know the guy. Right. And with him being on a bed about to lose his life, I couldn't sit up and still act like I had a big old beef with somebody who about to damn leave here, man, who I thought was about to leave here. So when I saw you was here standing in the gap for him, man, I just wanted to say salute. You look like your brother, man. And I think if you get custody of your brother, get around your brother, you're going to invoke the things in your brother that he needs to hear, man. Your brother do know God, but with you around, he'll know God more. And I think that change that needs to be made in his life, nobody knows what's going on in Keith's head right now, though. The change could be happening. Mm-hmm. But God has a strange way of putting us in places that nobody can speak to us, only him. And this is Keith's chance. So keep having hope, man, and having faith. And I see you put God first in everything, man. So you're going to be all right. And I'm going to let everybody else talk because I'm going to get with you on another level about this situation because I'm connected on it. Bro, when I show you what I want to show you, it's going to help you, too, with understanding your mama and her ways of action. Because I don't bash my mama either. I'm still with my mama at my mama. I'm still helping my mama.
Mm-hmm.
Still helping her in the same with her still acting like how she is. You see what I'm saying? So I want to share something with you as how I learned how to do that and how I had the power to do that.
I'm gonna send you my email. I'm gonna put my email in my community on YouTube and hit me up. Appreciate having the conversation with you, brother. Take care of yourself.
Salute.
Hey, Red.
How you doing?
I'm fine. How you doing? Finally glad to meet the Red 39.
Well, before we get to chopping it up, can we put the sidewalk sissy back in the basement for a minute? This only because he said his son was going to rape my daughter and my son, so I don't sit with that sidewalk sissy. You hear me?
I don't want no animosity here. We're going to keep it a neutral environment.
Can you give me my space?
Can you mute her, please?
Let him finish,
and I'm gonna put him down. But I just wanted. I don't want this for this, y'all. I just want it to be neutral, and everybody say what they have to say. Okay.
I'm not gonna address her on your platform because I'm gonna be the bigger person and the God-fearing person because she's very childish. And when we already see that, she's very childish and very immature and don't know when it's the place and when it's the time. She could have came up here and said her piece. I'm not gonna say nothing to her, but she had to say something to me. So that's why people know they can't work anywhere and do anything because they can't separate the two. But yeah. I would get down and allow her to speak.
Just stay right here. Stay right here, and I'll get to you next. Because I don't want no back and forth. Go ahead.
Right. Yes. This is bigger than just whether I can work with someone. When you say your son gonna rape my child, we don't play those games. But hello, how you doing, Mr. Jones?
I'm fine, Red. I'm glad to meet you. I've seen so many things online about you, but it's a pleasure to meet you, and I'm very grateful to have the opportunity to speak with you in the neutral platform.
That's right. Thank you for your service, my fellow vet.
And thank you for yours. I heard about you being involved with the military.
Involved 20 years. That's for sure. CW2, retired. You know what I'm saying? Wow. So I'm definitely was involved, fully involved. You might not think it because the shit I be involved in over there, but we always have to jump in and do a little extra for the woo-woo, whatever. Mm-hmm.
And also, before you continue, I want to thank you for donating to Save Key 419. It's a pleasure to see people. This is why I remain neutral, because just to get the support that he's getting is very vital in me having the opportunity to stand in the position where I can influence some of the decisions that's being made on my brother's behalf because of the support. It gives me a better position to be able to do that, if you can understand that, without me having to go through other avenues to do it, which I am going to do if it doesn't get to the place that I people need money. So as money is being donated, it gives me a better position to handle things the way that I want to handle it. So I want to commend you for that, stepping outside of yourself and outside of the big old world and saying, hey, you know, I'm giving for this cause regardless. And I'm sure that my brother would appreciate that. So thank you for that.
That's right, Kevin. Would you say that? Let me explain this before I even start asking questions. Mm-hmm. Number one, you know, I know Tommy K, Scammy K, Project Pat, whichever name you want to catch her by. She want to address me as the word ops. Okay. Me and Keith, if you watch me and Keith videos, if you went across any of them, you saw we argued. You saw he went in my personal background. You saw whatever he done with my son. But that was just nothing of, Keith was really trying to test me. See, Keith was one of the ones that he was used to people pulling on his coattail. Well, half of these people, scalps, the Tommy K's, all those people over there, the KOBs, these are people that grabbed on your brother's coattail and was hoping to come on a come up. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. See, when your brother came in my room, it went different for him. Somebody paid me to kick him out my room. Mm-hmm. So your brother said, okay, let's make a deal. I get kicked out every day, but you're going to give me a percentage. And I said, fuck you. No. You know what I'm saying? This is my room. You come to my room, and now you want me to pay you off of what they doing in my room. I said, mm-hmm. no. So it went to a little stand your ground type thing. You know, so it was like he was trying to bully me. So when he pulled my little information, hey, it pissed me off. But in at the end, I did file bankruptcy. My son had been to jail. So really, it was no ill will and hatred because he still was lying to me, but he knew I wasn't trying to pull on his coattail. Mm-hmm. So in reality, Keith fucked with me, but he didn't want to just come and say it because I was the one that talked back. He was mm-hmm. used to controlling. So he knew he wasn't going to control me, but he knew I was a strong nail for him. You get mm-hmm. what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So you know your brother, and if you get what I'm saying, it was bigger than that. So me giving to you and for the need for your brother, it wasn't no, like, thought to me. It was second nature because I felt your pain because I am a sister. It's just mm-hmm. me and my brother. You know what I'm saying? Right. We lost our mama 2 years ago, but
I'm sorry to hear that.
Thank you. But I could put myself in your shoes. Right now, if my brother, something was to happen and I couldn't see him, I could feel that pain. I even cried. And that's the honest God's truth because mm-hmm. I got a heart. And a lot of them act heartless, but deep down, the ones that they claiming are the ops, they got hearts too. Because you see how they changed and how they've been turning and they've been standing up because the app is the app and it's real people. And you guys, what y'all are going through is real life. So mm-hmm. I do come and take different things dealing with y'all, but I do keep it at a respectful level because mm-hmm. I remember this is real life. But mm-hmm. so
let me say something about that too, real quick. Mm-hmm. You know, when I seen the videos between you and my brother, but I seen your face when and a lot of other people felt, I think people felt what I felt after his birthday. And I made that video after his birthday. And I watched your live
right.
when you had picked up that video of me talking about what the circumstances that led to me making that video, because I was waiting on getting the opportunity to see my brother. And I took off work. I waited around all day. Then I got to see my brother, pictures of him online. And I was told that, I'm going to call you and you're going to be able to see your brother today. Never got the call. Waited around all day. And that's just real life. Right. You know what I'm saying? That, I mean, you can't, even the people that was coming on your live and they was talking and saying the things that they were saying, they could feel the pain of that experience. You know, this, the truth of the matter is, what a lot of people don't know, they was getting ready to pull the plug on Keith. That's the truth.
Yeah.
That's the truth. That's exactly what his daughter told me. They had given up on Keith. They said, do you want to see your dad? Do you think he's the kind of person that you wanted, that he would want to deal with life in going forward with this situation? So the things, the barriers that he's overcoming now is because of God, because of the strength of his fighting for survival. Right. You know what I'm saying? You can see that in that video when his daughter was fighting my mom. He was trying to get up with everything he had.
Yeah.
He was, and you gotta imagine if you sitting in the bed red and you see your daughter or your son, and you in a state where you could somebody could pull the plug, and you still trying to do everything you can to help your daughter or your son.
Right.
That's humanity.
Yes.
This ain't got nothing to do with Beagle. This ain't got nothing to do with what nobody did to me. That's it's it. a it's I don't know how we can't have a human response to that. And I said, how can we not have a heart about that situation? Because all of us would fight for our kids, given if they was in that situation. And that's why I'm here. I'm here for that cause and that cause only. People have said the most vicious things about me, and I maintain the same thing. I only got on people who said that they was for my brother, and they was saying and doing things that was crazy. I never got on nobody that keeps saying anything about. They called me all kind of bitches and niggas, sorry nigga, jealous and all this stuff, and clout chasing and all. I never said nothing to them because it proved right, because even people that's perceived as Keith's enemies are donating to him. And I'm the only neutral ground in which they would do that, because they definitely not going to do it with Tommy K, because people don't really feel Tommy K.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? So this, and I don't understand how they can't feel it over in on Tommy K's side and the people that's in the church on that side, because we still getting money on the other side.
Right.
For my brother. So why wouldn't you encourage that?
Yeah. And you know why I want to encourage it? Because it's a control mechanism. See, the thing, mm-hmm. if you shut that thing down over there with Tommy K and everything, I feel like the church or whatever she's holding on over there with the bingo money-wise, it'll draw up too. And it's slowly drawing up. She's slowly mm-hmm. going back to trade to pick up her money, whether she want to admit it or not. And it's a pride thing. It's because Kevin O came up and stepped up when you said Kevin won his brother in the beginning. Like, this right. is somebody that act like she knew Keith so fucking bad. But you're going to say this man didn't have a brother. But yet, you playing a video about him in a motorcycle 3 years ago. Like, which is it? Do we got a brother or do we got a video talking about a brother? Make right. it make sense. Right. You get what I'm saying? So, right. you got to understand what Keith had over there with them group of people. Some of those people do not have brains. They have to be led. They have to be coached. They have to be directed. That's why as soon as you go live, as soon as you say something, which we mentioned her name, Scammy K, she's going to play this video. And she's got to hurry up and debunk and change the wording and switch. You notice she'll pause and she'll play and she'll change the narrative 100 million times. You be like, bitch, that ain't what I said. Like, right. what? Are y'all really going? And then you watch the comments. You're like, yeah. You be like, y'all so fucking stupid. Trust me, you ain't the only one going through the pain. We mm-hmm. see what she does. Yeah. And it's a game. And it's the lady got the background of scamming. It's bad that your mom trusted her. It's bad that your mom allowed her to come down there. Like, I wish they would have listened at you in the beginning. You definitely told them, let's keep it internal. Don't involve Bingo. Because right. we know Keith would have never wanted that. None of this that don't happen. We know, like I tell everybody, I studied Keith. When I had to go up against Keith, I had to do what you did. I had to go watch your brother videos. Mm-hmm. And I watched him. He was a commotion starter, a shit starter. That was his kick. To go mm-hmm. in every room, cuss out, do this. So I had to study his patterns to know. But I knew one thing he did do. He exposed himself before somebody else exposed him.
Mm-hmm.
So this exposing of him, showing different things, how he looking, I know that's not what he wanted. He wanted right. wanted your mother on here. None of this, how they dragged you, none of that. So at the end of the day, I don't even think it's important what those people are doing now, because Keith is fighting a different fight right now.
Yeah.
But just the fact of what you stood up and you come to took this money and you start taking it, that's the right thing to do. It was right. the time and it was the place, and keep doing it. Don't deter from it, no matter what they try to say, no matter what they try to kick up, because you is his brother and you standing in the gap, and it belongs to you to do that for him. You know?
And I am. I'm doing it with all honesty and integrity. Of course, dealing with money, that's something different. That's something that I didn't want to do due to the people that's in charge. But my only thing is, if money is the thing that's moving everything, then if I cut into that revenue, I know you got to come and talk to me. I know his baby mama's going to need stuff. His kids is going to need stuff. And as opposed to me not receiving anything, they probably wouldn't even reach out to me. But now, you know, if you got $1,600 sitting around and this man is saying, hey, if you need something, come to me. And I got a ledger. I'm holding myself accountable, not because I trust these individuals, but it's the fact that they know what's going on, as opposed to the fact that Tommy K has expressed that she just sending things indiscriminately without no accountability to the person who is connected to Keith. That's, he's not getting the money. Right. Things is not getting paid.
Yeah.
So me holding them accountable and being accountable for the money, this is something that I know my brother would want, because he about X's and O's. You see what I'm saying? He not, right. It ain't always, he was talking about leaving the app. He told me the day before he got in the accident, he was planning to go to Texas. Yeah. See what I'm saying? Like, it wasn't all about, he didn't even, he said he didn't have, he didn't have, he was driving his, he was happy to have his Sprinter van and to start this business. And he was driving to Phoenix and staying in the truck. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He was doing stuff to really try to better his life. And I'm not going to let nobody take advantage of my brother. You know what I'm saying? I know how my mom is. My mom has spent my money when I was in Iraq. My mom spent my taxes when I was in jail. I depended on my brother to hold my money until I got out. And when I got out, I paid him what he had sent me, but he had kept my money. So I think that this is the best thing that I could do for him. This is the only way I can return the favor for my brother, that if something was to happen, he has something here. You know what I'm saying? Or his kids can be taken care of. And I can say, Keith, you know, LeBron needed some, you know, school clothes, or one of his kids needed something and I was there for him. You see what I'm saying? That's the least I can do for my brother. I'm not going to let nobody take advantage of him. Just like you, Wayne. That you said you got an only brother.
Yeah.
You're That's doing, not, right doing the right thing.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Now, I do got a question.
Uh-huh.
Now, what's the girls at? The girls that you have custody of that was at the house. Well, who got them?
The girls? Oh, where are they? Or
what they, like, I know you, they was, last we knew was those girls stayed with Keith. So, like, do they not, like, I know the grandmother jumped on her, but where are the kids at now? Is they back with their mom?
The last that I heard was they were back with their mother. I haven't talked to them since that incident. One of the girls that was choked was one of the girls that Keith had custody of, the one that was saying, hey, I'm just trying to talk to my dad. My mom don't have a good relationship with them girls. She never did, because those girls are hard to handle. They've had trouble with following after the rules of their mother. That's the reason why they was with their dad. And Keith was trying to straighten out that situation by taking responsibility for the girls. In fact, those two girls was with him when he dropped me off after we spent time fishing. They was with him at that time, and he was going to take them to go get something to eat when he dropped me off. So and that's the whole thing that's gotten lost in translation. These girls, which I haven't seen for some time. I haven't seen. I think they went back to their mother. That was the last thing that I heard. And they just out here now. You know what I'm saying? Without their dad, they just back to doing, I don't know where they are. I haven't seen them since then. I don't even know where his oldest daughter is. I think she went back to where she lived out of state. So I don't know where they are. And that's sad to me. Because right. he was the only lifeline for them girls, because they were something to handle. They really was, you know. And he had gotten to an argument with Shay about them because I guess they was going out of town. Shay and Danny was going out of town, and they didn't want to take those two girls. And they had gotten into an argument about that because he thought that they should have invited the two girls that he had custody of, and he was upset with her about that. So they wasn't even on good terms before that accident. So yeah, that's what happened. I don't know what happened to him. I don't hear from him or nothing. I don't know what's going on with them. So I don't know what's going on with them. I didn't have custody of them or anything like that. They just came over a couple of times, and I talked to them a couple of times, but they were staying at Keith's house with their older sister before she left. And then I guess they went back with their mom.
Okay. So
I've been trying to find them, though. I don't know where they are.
Right. Oh, man, that sucks. That really sucks. So the older sister, the one that had the POA, that's not the same as the two that were staying there.
She's the Keith's oldest daughter. Okay. And she stays out of town. She's not she was the one that had, so she was the next of kin, so she was the one who had the POA. She right. wasn't here initially when the accident happened. So but it was just my mom and Shay that went up to the hospital. She didn't come until sometime later on, after she heard about the accident that happened. So she came up here after that. And of course, Keith is a lot to handle due to the nature of who he is. Mm-hmm. And she didn't, that's a lot to deal with that one person. And then she had pressure from my mom. She had pressure from Shay. And I think that when she was up there on that video, she was talking about relinquishing the power of attorney to someone because she was trying to find somebody to give it to because she couldn't handle the responsibility. She even told me that on several different occasions. She said that, you know, she was having a hard time dealing with my mom. And I put the text messages on one of my videos on here, the things that she was saying. And that's a heavy burden to have for a daughter her age that's vibrant, that want to be doing what she want to do and living life. Not that she didn't care about her dad, but that's a major responsibility. And they didn't have a good relationship. I don't think they talked since January, she told me. She haven't talked to her dad since January. They didn't have a good relationship. So it's a complicated situation.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So for what up? Because I know you're not going to talk too much about what you're doing behind the scenes to try to get some way that you could see Keith. But is she part of trying to help you so that you can get to see Keith? Or is it past anything to do with her?
That's the complicated thing. In order for me to get the paperwork done, I need the next of kin signature on the paperwork. I got the money. I can do it. But I got to know the doctor, and I got to have the next of kin signature. And then they're going to go about talking to Keith, which he's cognizantly aware of things where he can speak his home. He can say what he want to say. And I didn't want to say it, but it doesn't make a difference at this point. This is the things that I'm doing behind the scenes that nobody knows about that I'm trying to do, but I need help because I don't know a lot of things about, you know, certain things that I need to know in order to go about doing what I need to do. It's a complicated thing once legalities come into play. You know, you got to go to court, you got to, you know, people got to go in and speak to him. And so they need signatures, they need clearance from doctors and things of that nature, and pretty much that's locked up. So as a result, I had to come to these tactics, which was the last thing that I wanted to do, right. Deal with people's money. You know, that was the this is the last ditch effort of anything that I could do outside of what I can't do, you know, with the legalities of it. You see what I'm saying? This put me in a complex situation. So I'm doing all that I can at this point in time. And hopefully, you know, with other family members that's talking to my mom, as well as me getting these CAs and, you know, me making a play with this, it may bend or break the circumstances, which I'm hoping, you know, I just believe that if you do right, right things will happen. And that's right. I just got to go by my faith. You know what I'm saying? But I'm doing everything that I possibly can because my brother called to speak to me. I stopped everything that I was doing because I came on here to get away from all the drama from Instagram because they was taking my videos and stuff. They was, you know, going and putting it online and all that stuff. And I just came over here and I said, I'm just going to wait it out and see what. And when I heard my brother, my cousin text me and said, man, your brother said he wanted to see you. He been trying to call you. He been trying to pick up the phone and call you. He been at what Lano number? Give me Lano number. And they wouldn't give him my number because my mom would not let him call me. And he been, you know, he got the phone and trying to call me and he can't call me.
Right.
You know, and my mom said, no, don't let him talk to Lano. Don't. And I just don't know why that is. If the man trying to talk to me, why you won't let him talk to me? You know what right. I'm saying? And that's why I'm doing what I'm doing. Other than that, I had to stop and do everything, put everything on hold so I can be able to do what I could. Once he said he wanted to talk to me, you know what I'm saying? Once he said he wanted, I changed everything. I stopped everything.
Right. So tell me this, Kevin. If the process was to end up that the people come in the house and they do what they got to do and Keith say what he want, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the way we saw your mom react, maybe she get to the position to say, okay, you want to do this? Now you take him on. And I want no dealing with him no more then, right? Mm-hmm. And she relinquished taking care of Keith. Are you ready to do Keith?
Yes. And I can say that, see, the problem is that people don't realize that there are other family members that's willing to come in and step in and to assist. I won't be able to. Now, I work. I have a family. My family is comprised of 7 people that I have to provide for. So me being a primary caretaker for a full day, I'm not going to take on the weight of that responsibility. But there are other people that are willing to come in to assist, which my mom has prohibited. Shay, Ghost, right? So mm-hmm. A lot of these people that's been connected to this situation for some time are alienated from Keith solely because of the fact that my mom has distanced everybody from it. We have family members that's willing to come in that can stay full time with Keith, right? Mm-hmm. It's not just me. When you see me, you don't see everybody else that's behind me that supports me. They just not getting online. They not as boisterous and articulate as I am, but they fully support what I'm doing. I played a video, a voicemail of my aunt saying, hey, when you gonna get Keith? Because what are you doing to get Keith? Because XYZ. They want to see Keith. They are going to be, we're going to do this as a family. It's not going to be one person that is going to do it. It's going to be all of us together. And my mom has prohibited that. That is the problem. And I think that because the she's being supported by these people, is she can take this stance of pushing everybody out the way and not mean, because she says she don't have a job, right? So if you don't have a job, how are you taking care of your bills? Well, if these people are sending money in, you don't have to work. But if these people stop doing that and say, let's focus on Keith. Let's focus on the real issue, which is family involvement, which I have said and several other people have said that is of necessity to ensure that Keith's development goes expeditiously instead of being stagnated by the people that he loves is not in his life.
Right, right.
So it's going to be everybody that's going to be involved as a result of me being involved. And I would even let my mom come in because she is able to do certain things. She helped my grandmother during that time when she was when she needed help before her passing. So my mom is very well capable, but because of the estrangement of the relationships that she has with the family, it stagnates everybody's ability to be involved, and it just centers in on her to be the primary sole person that's dealing with Keith. She got to carry Keith up and down the stairs, which is very difficult. I talked to Ghost about that, and he said, man, that guy is something to lift up. And I you know, my mom, she's doing all this stuff by herself. And it's ridiculous. Wow. Just because she don't like certain people. I don't like you, so I don't want you around. Well, Keith want those people around. He's calling for those people. And because you don't have a good relationship with those people, you're not allowing him the ability to be able to, you know, for you to have help and for him to have this internal development that he needs in order to get back to his normal self. And I say Keith is about at 35-45%, I would say. Yeah. When I seen him, when I seen him, he was just staring at me and he was sitting in the chair and he looked at me. And it just sit with me to this day.
Right.
You know.
So do any of his kids see him right now?
I don't know. I don't know who my mom is allowing to see him at this point in time because I'm not there. But I know that he's seen. I know my uncle been over there. Two of my uncles been over there. And they're saying the very same thing that I'm saying, that they're trying to push mom to get everybody else involved. He needs to see Shay. Like I said before, I don't really favor Shay. But is I don't get in between anybody's relationship. I just don't like what she did when it comes to me, with me looking out for my brother. But that's another story. But he needs to see Shay, and he definitely needs to see Ghost. Mm-hmm. Those are the people that he entrusted himself to prior to his accident. So those people need to be involved. I don't care what nobody's saying about him. I don't care what Tommy K saying about their relationship, all that crap. I don't get into that. We shouldn't even be discussing that. If the primary goal is to ensure Keith's recovery, he needs to be around the people that he entrusted himself to. That them just facts.
So also, listen, I know you said you want to save a lot of that money, but do you think, like, if it come down, because I'm praying that you do get in the position that you do have your brother and everybody's around him. Do you think you invest in one of those good workout machines for him? Because I think that will be a good recovery tool for him. Because when I look at money being sent for him and for him, I'm looking at like good, like, you know, how we be saying, oh, these celebrities, they recover so fast because they got all that money, right? You know, and he getting good money when people donate and they doing. Do you think that would be a good tool you might decide to invest in, if you know, in the near? Because I think that would be something good for his recovery.
Well, see, that's the most fortunate thing about me being involved in this situation. I will be very transparent in what I think would be best for Keith. And I would take advice from other people. Of course, I'm not around in his day-to-day needs, but whatever that he will need, I know that whatever that I have would go in support of that. So if he needs that, that's what he will have. And I will ensure that everyone knows that as well, that has provided donations and things of that nature. And that's just a part of accountability. I think that's being responsible. So right now, while we're speaking, we're at 1662 dollars and 79 cents. If it costs for him to have some kind of machinery or equipment that he needs for his well-being, he will be provided with that, with the funds that I have, if that's what's necessary for that situation. So I do agree.
Donate,
with you,
y'all. Save Keith 419. Donate. Save Keith 419. Please. Definitely a good cause. It's for that brother to get through. And, you know, another question I do have. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now it keeps saying his car got repoed or his car got taken back. Are we referring to just the Sprinter, or is it another car that got taken?
No, it was his car, but I cannot go into detail about it right now. I will not, because people have stated that I've said too many things, and I don't come out and say anything until somebody else come out and say something. Then I come out and say, well, this is the truth. I'm here to validate things.
Okay.
I'm not here to just put out things indiscriminately, but his Sprinter van is gone. And there's an issue with his car. He no longer has his car at this point in time, but I cannot go into why he does not have his car. The saving grace of the matter is that he cannot drive it anyway. So, but he does not have a car at this point in time. I can't go into it until somebody comes out and say something. And then once I get wind of it, then I'll bring forth the truth, because see, the problem is people are not telling the truth, and so it's hidden, and I want people to know what's going on that are donors. If you're donating things, that's what I said from the very beginning. We have to be transparent with people when you're taking people's money.
Right.
To a certain degree.
Oh, yeah. And I believe that. I believe that, and I get it. And that's why I said, I don't understand anybody. If anybody's still out there going against what Kevin said, Kevin ain't lied. Kevin ain't switched up. Kevin ain't swayed. Kevin took the abuse from people that he ain't even know, that he ain't even encounter, you know. And then he opening up telling y'all how much he's getting, what he plan on doing with the money. Every day he come up and say the different prices, you know. Right now, we still ain't heard nothing from Tommy K. Mm-hmm. And no breakdowns or nothing. And it's just been insults after insults after insults thrown out there with this behavior. So I'm forever going to support you, Kevin, because, I'm a sister. That's all it is. I'm a sister, so I understand the brother fight. So that's all I had.
And I appreciate you coming and talking to me. I look forward to it. You know, I always send a shout out to you, and you know, I don't care nothing about that other stuff. I just care about people being people, and that's the side I stand on. So I really appreciate you coming up. I appreciate you donating. Blessings to you and your family. Take care of yourself. Right.
Let me tell you the last thing your brother did with me. He showed up in my life, and I think this was like either the morning of his accident. I think it was the day of his accident. He showed up in my life, and he jumped up in a box. And I was looking down, and he go to talking, and I looked up, and I started grinning. He said, see, I came in here and I made you smile. He said, see, little bitch, I was finna go off on you. He said, I'm gonna leave because you gave me that smile, so I made your day. And he left and he went and argued with somebody else. So our last encounter, to me, that was our peace offering at that moment. Because he said, I was coming to come fuck with you, but I'm leaving.
That's how he is too. He a mess. He the same way with the family. He just an agitator, but that's why we love Keith. He bring that unique personality that we don't always get. And he's very charismatic. So for people to say that I'm jealous of my brother is ridiculous. I always love my brother. I could stand behind my brother and support him if he's doing the right thing. I don't have no problem with doing that. I've never been the flamboyant type. I've always been a family guy and very loving and nurturing and supportive of my brother. So, you know, especially when he's doing right. If he's doing wrong, I tell him he's doing wrong and I leave it at that. I just didn't know this big old character. So, yeah, right. That's just how he is to us. You know, he the same way with all the family. As much as he get on your nerves, he get on our nerves too. He get under our skin. Y'all, listen, we would be real enemies of Keith because he didn't did some shit to us that you don't. I'm telling you.
Right. So, a little mad.
Yeah, but I appreciate talking to you, Red 39. I'm gonna be here. I appreciate you donating to Keith and showing the human side and blessings to you and your family. Take care of yourself.
All right.
I'm gonna bring up Trina B. All right. I can't hear you, Trina.
Oh, you can hear me now. I have myself muted.
Okay.
The points or some stuff. I got some answers to even in that conversation with Red. Sometimes you have to be a bigger person in some situations and just let bygones be bygones. But it was some questions I wanted to ask you. As well. With Shay, do you think Shay put out all the videos of Keith? Because it was one particular video, in the particular video with him in the bathroom, I think that was the worst video I've seen. That was the worst video most people
seen,
because nobody knew why somebody would record that particular moment of somebody shitting on the toilet stool. That it got up under my skin, because I'm in the medical field. I've been in the medical field before. It was like, why would you want to record that moment? That's not progress. That's a personal moment.
Right.
Baby, you don't even do that to a child. And,
right.
And I don't know if you noticed, they zoomed in even on the belt. They zoom in even on his face where the scar was. They even show him shaking before all that. So it was deliberately done. And I want to know why. And you can really use that in court as an advantage of whoever took that video right there. They had a motive. And from my understanding, it was your mother. From what I'm understanding, it was your mother that took that video of the toilet. But I don't know if she gave it to Shay, if she showed other people, what did she do when it comes to it. But my point of why was it even recorded? That's my thing. It should be everybody concerned. Why would you record that moment? What was your motive? Was you trying to, I don't know, hold someone?
I would say the person who is responsible is the person that's in charge solely. We know that my mom is in charge. As to the videos getting out, those were on personal cameras. So it had to be either Shay or my mom.
But I'm going to play this very, to you with what Shay said. She didn't know nothing about. I don't know if you heard that when Shay said that in that video, but she was talking to Ghost at that particular time. And I'm going to play this. I'm gonna play this part. So I want you to hear.
Okay.
I want you to hear this, because Shay kind of. Hold on.
It won't happen again.
Oh, listen. I kept this because I like
it. It's a fucked up feeling. It won't happen again.
So where the video come from that he talking about him using the bathroom and all that? Where that video come from?
His mom recorded that video.
Oh,
that's not my video.
Oh, okay. Just asking.
So Brett, that shouldn't the shade denies the fact that of that video that and I don't know if she had that video or did she release it, but she said his mom has that video. I don't have that video.
Yeah, but I don't know where. See, the problem is who would have access to those personal videos? And then the thing, though, because those are on private cameras, private phones, right? And then another question was, one of the other videos that got out was the video of Shay talking to Keith, when she was asking him, what is her name?
That's the video Shay said she put out. Shay admitted that she engaged trusting somebody when they did that. But she said the video of the one. I don't believe she gave the one of Keith's mother fighting or the one of the other. I think they're saying the daughter gave the one when it's fighting. So I don't know.
Well, what I was told was that people had the password. And the password was sent out to various people who had access to that camera that was in the hospital room, because I got that from someone. I never disclosed who I got it from, but I had the actual username and the password. But that does not explain how did the personal phone videos got out, because those got out to them. But I do know that Shay acknowledged that she has sent out some videos. She acknowledged that. Now, those private videos that was from my mom, and we went back and looked at it from just looking at it from the perspective of just where the videos come from, you have to ask the question, how did that personal iPhone or Android video get out along with the video that got out from the Blue Ram camera? Yeah. But the only one that we know acknowledged that the videos got out was Shay.
Yeah.
She was the only one who came forth and said that she had probably sent out some videos to people, because even the video with Keith playing dominoes with ghosts. I seen that video. I have that video in my phone.
Yes.
That was on her camera. That video is out.
Yes.
As well. I got it. So she has been sending videos out indiscriminately, and I can only go by what she said at the beginning, where she said that she was upset about the fact that I was speaking out in public about Keith. When I first came out, she had sent me a text message. Are you talking to other people? Well, you on Bigo with Danny and Nunu, and then you got Journey in our private family, Marco Polo, and then now you sending videos out, and you just came out and said it. So I just question her character, and I think that it has something to do with either my mom or Shay. It can't be nobody else, because they're the two people who recorded these videos.
I think both of them made the mistakes of sending stuff out to people. I think it was both. I think it was both, because I'm looking at it from a different angle. People just ever send out people videos just to get back at people. Look like to me, it's either right. That was deliberately done to get back at certain people and to do things to for shock value, you know, to do stuff.
Yeah.
Because
they covered up by saying that, see, this is another thing that Visa brought up in the video, which I had a question about too, is the fact that when they put the videos out, it was to show Keith's progress, but they didn't give it to Tommy K. Why didn't Tommy K have the video? She should have been the first person who had the video for his progress. If the progress was about him being on the toilet and him talking and saying that he needs somebody to wipe his ass, and that was a progressive video, then why didn't Tommy K had it? It just doesn't make any sense to me. But I, the the two people that I hold responsible is Shay and my mother. Period.
Tell me, that's not a progressive video for him to be.
It's not.
That I don't give a damn what nobody say. That's not, and nobody should never have recorded that moment at all. They shouldn't have a camera even pointed at him on that. And that's just my opinion on that, because that's just taking away, dehumanizing him, his military.
Right.
It's taking away his dignity. It's all that. It's all of that. And we know who Keith is. Keith would never have wanted that kind of vision of him put out there.
And let me tell you something, Trina B. This is another thing. Both my mom and Shay, they know that. Because when I played the video in my last video, I show where my mom acknowledged that Keith was a famous person. And she knew that people were inquiring about his whereabouts when she was at the hospital. They were getting calls at the hospital. So she knew that Keith would not want that to be something that was put out as progress to keep, because she even told the family in the Marco Polo. So that's why I hold both of them accountable. I'm going by what they said. I'm just going by what they said. Both of them acknowledged that Keith was a private person. He was on Bigo, and we didn't want certain things to get out, and they are putting this shit out. So I hold them responsible. It don't have nothing. Dill is just a person who got the videos, who may have paid for the videos, wherever he got the videos from. But Dill did not take the recordings. Dill did not take the pictures. So y'all can shut that shit up. The people that's responsible is the people that was right there in that room that were taking videos and taking pictures. So we can stop all that noise about Dill. I don't want to hear about that, because if you're going to get Dill, you're going to have to get the people that was in the hospital that was taking the videos. And both Trina B and I said the same thing, as well as Visa, that was wrong to show somebody's progress by showing somebody sitting on the goddamn toilet. Shut that shit up. I don't want to hear that.
Man, that's absurd.
It's like, ridiculous. It's disgusting.
That's not disgusting. And that's really cause of a concern. And that's really abuse. Really.
To be honest. It is. It's a crime. It's a crime in several states.
It's an abuse.
If you work in the medical field, you know that's something that you cannot do under no circumstances. It's a violation of his privacy rights.
And then for somebody even try to justify that was even sick. Just to try to justify that even sick, you know.
Which Tommy K and her people is trying to do. They trying to
justify. There's no justification in that. And that's the thing. No justification.
None. In
action at all. I don't care what nobody say. There's no justification. They make a justification for wrongdoing. If you can't admit when somebody's wrong, you are lost cause. That's wrong is wrong, right is right.
That's why I can't even listen to them people over there. I can't even take them serious, because they justify shit that we all know.
Most of the church people knew this. They knew that Keith was trying to get a relationship back with his mom and loved his mom, but he did not trust her. He did not trust her for her to be even the sole person over his estate, his life, his health, and all that. I knew as a so-called op that Keith did not trust her. And the only person that he really, that I knew that he trusted was Dr. Shay. We knew that Shay was the number one person that he talked about more than anybody. And he will make that clear.
Right.
That Shay was the person that he trusted.
Right.
All that, if anybody was going to be the sole person, Shay. But they said Shay, from what I'm understanding, Shay didn't want to even have nothing to do with the power turning, because the daughter was going to give it to Shay. Even in that video, I'm listening to her. She said she offered it to Shay, but the mother said, no, don't give it to Shay. You could give it to me. I had him and you had that was some of the frustration, because I think that was some of the frustration with her, because she wanted control And that was something that frustrated the devil. She came in and said, "No, don't disrespect me. Don't disrespect." Well, I don't know what she said. Respect from, and she's and
she wasn't being disrespectful. That's how my mom is. She was looking for that.
She was looking
for any kind of angle she can get on them on that girl, so she can take that power of attorney over. She did, and the things that people don't know what happened after that situation. If I was to say it, it would put everything in perspective. But I haven't said that. See, they talking about I'm a hater of my mom and I'm against my mom, but there's certain things that I haven't even said.
I don't really believe that that daughter, knowing your mother, would have relinquished that full responsibility on your mother. I think it's some foolery in that when it comes to the power of attorney. I really don't think your mama got full power of attorney. I think that daughter do still, and because your mother was in second in charge behind her, I think that's what happened. But I just, me personally, I don't believe she got it. I just don't see that.
Well, Trina B, stop talking, and I ain't heard nothing that you said. But I appreciate talking to you. I got to get off of here. I appreciate having a conversation with you. I appreciate you donating. I want to get to some more questions if possible from the other people. I'm going to be on here another time if you want to ask me questions. But thank you for coming. I really appreciate you donating too.
Keep doing what I'm going to do and to help out any way I could, because it's a blessing to see you as a brother stepping up to the plate to do the right thing. And I feel like accountability is the most important thing in this situation, especially on the circumstances of the family dynamics of what's going on. So it got to be accountability. All right, and I'll talk to you later, man.
Okay, blessings to you, brother. Take care of yourself and your family.
Bye-bye.
So, this is how we're supposed to do things, guys. I don't try to get on the Bigo stuff. I treat people like people. I'm very transparent. And that's what I'm here for. I'm here for the love of my brother and to get the support that he needs and to get everybody around him that loves him so he can have a full recovery. Everybody want him at 100%, don't you? Well, there's a certain condition that we must meet in order to enable that to happen. And it takes somebody that's going to be neutral, that's going to be loving, that's going to be transparent, and love enemies and friends alike. So the picture that they painting out is not the picture that what goes with the ideology of the support that Keith needs at this time. People are saying a lot of things that are not in Keith's best interest, and they're creating narratives to keep division and separation. And all of us have family members and loved ones, no matter if we friend or foe. We love our families, and this is an opportunity for us to have growth in this situation. This just did not affect me. This affected everybody in this situation. And my brother is, he needs me, and I can't be there for him solely because somebody is not permitting me to be there. Not because I don't want to, and that's not fair. So I appreciate the Bigo people for coming over here and involving themselves in this situation and supporting a worthy cause. If you truly for my brother, this is where you're going to come. This is what love looks like in the Black community, when you can bring both friend and foe together and we can come for a common cause and understand that this is a person, not a character. So I'm going to take some questions before I go. How would someone need to see that type of progress, though? That's a deflection tactic. How would someone need to see that? I don't know what you're saying right there. Maybe I missed something. Kevin, just say sorry and you could be there. Sorry. Sorry, Mom. I don't know for what. It didn't work. It's not going to work. You just don't know Regina. You don't know Baby D. If you knew Baby D, then I'm not going to say I'm sorry about something that I didn't do. What did I do? If you could come up here and show what I did, then I say I'm sorry to her. It won't work. People been kissing her ass for a while. That's the reason why ain't nothing changing. She's not getting better. But everything is in God's hand at this point. So whatever God see fit, it doesn't. You know, I'm concerned about my mother and my brother. So private conversation, private chat. Peace, love, brother. Yeah, we're gonna keep with this fight, we're gonna keep it going on, and that's what I want to do. I love each and every one of you, and I'm looking forward to growth in our community and loving one another and stand for the right cause, and take care of yourselves tonight. Get some rest. I don't know about them Cowboys. I'm a 49er fan. Right? You ain't gonna see no Cowboy stuff around here. Sorry. But y'all take care of yourself. And as usual, I'm gonna go out with a song.
I put it down for the LBC. I put it down for a place called Queen. You know I represent the 213. I hold it down for the Mexican team. I keep the gangster for all my kids. I keep all the PYTs, but they all car keys. I put it down for all my battle ladies, ladies, ladies. That's all the buggy shit. Yeah, get it back. We gon' dance to this one, sure. I tried to look the other way, but baby, pass me by. I saw you holding cute and standing, girl, I damn near died. The way you hold that cosmo just fits you to a T. But I just wish that you was sitting to me. I wonder what was on God's mind the day that he made you. I know he wrote a new commandment after he was through. But every time I see you, I find something new. But I just gotta have you. I really want you. I just gotta have you. I really want you. I just got to have you. Being that you still were eating at the servant's food, and my daughter's skin in fact was sick when I took, and all the love was such it, your body was inside. I couldn't finish breakfast. That's something just ain't right. That's what it's looking like. What the hell is wrong with you? I said, I know you understand. You've been through a few, but this one was special. A special to me. Is this just my imagination? Killing me.